wake of Birds of Prey's box office implosion, there has been a very unfortunate takeaway from fans and haters alike. And that's that men don't want to see female-led action movies, and that women alone aren't a strong enough audience to support blockbuster movies. I think they're coming from people just being incredibly disappointed and having an emotional over-response to Birds of Prey failing and not looking at the obvious reasons that it failed. And then also, I think people are trying to scare and guilt people into seeing it at second weekend. I see a lot of shady tactics for trying to get the Birds of Prey box office numbers up. But again, I broke down Birds of Prey in my box office report this week. There's a link down below in the video description as to why it didn't work out. So many reasons. But here we're going to talk about female-led action movies in general, where they've, why, how they need to be constructed to work, and what's going to happen the rest of this year, because it's a big year for female-led blockbusters. Let's hope. All right, so now at first glance, you might think, right, that these statements are correct, right? Because Birds of Prey is the latest female action flick to underperform or downright fail at the box office. And it would seem to be part of a disturbing, disappointing trend if you were just looking at it from the surface, or not taking even a few seconds to think about it, all right? Because it's a very obvious and honest answer as to what the problem is. And that's that these films made the exact same mistake, and that they failed to have strong supporting male characters. Now, I'm sure that many of you are appalled by that statement and furiously typing down below, why should female-led films need to cater to men? Well, male-led films have been doing that since the beginning of Hollywood, because no single demographic can deliver blockbuster-sized box office. Women, of course, can't deliver on their own a blockbuster because there just simply aren't enough of them. Just like only men can't deliver a strong blockbuster box office either. And on that note, every single major franchise has had strong female characters in each movie. Even Bond has his Bond girls, yet that is beginning to seem dated to audiences and is having an impact on the box office. And now, as Hollywood tries to flip the script and have female characters drive these movies, you need to flip the entire formula. I don't see how people don't understand something that's so obvious. You need to flip the entire formula and have strong supporting roles for men so they feel included, just as for, again, not just decades, since Hollywood began. Female supporting roles in the past, strong female supporting roles, have made women feel included. Now, flipping the whole script, the whole formula, is why trailblazing female-led franchises like Alien and the Hunger Games worked. They had strong male supporting characters, especially in the first two Alien movies, which were the most successful. And then more recently, Wonder Woman, Captain Marvel, and even the new Star Wars trilogy did the same. Very important. There are, of course, exceptions to everything. And here you have Lord of the Rings, which has almost no female characters, yet was very successful. That's almost like a fantasy war movie, though, so I think that kind of works for that reason. And then also the recent Joker film. Joker really didn't have strong female roles either, even though they did try to play up Zazie Beetz and his mother, not really in the movie. But I think Joker transcended that because of the mythology and the mental illness and its larger message, you know, in terms of, it really resonated with a lot of people across the globe who saw it multiple times, which I think helped push it into the billion-dollar club. And then with all women films, right? Now, the first Sex and the City was a pop culture moment, so it did particularly well. And then you have Kill Bill, which was generally well-received, perhaps due to Quentin Tarantino's very strong male energy behind the camera, even though sometimes he appears on screen, but he has such a strong presence in his movies no matter what, even when he's not on screen. Although I have to add, Kill Bill was very low at the box office. Very, very low. Like, that was like before I think people paid as close attention to box office as they do now. And Kill Bill couldn't even get to 100 million, the century mark, which is really a mark that shows a movie is even done moderately well at the box office domestically. Now, as I said, 2020 is supposed to be a big year for women, in front of and behind the camera, when it comes to blockbuster films. And as Birds of Prey kicks things off with a big disappointment, many are wondering and are fearful if the whole damn year it's going to be that big of a bummer. So let's take a look. And remember, this is a business. And the best thing that Hollywood can do for these female-led movies is to have them be successes. All right, so Mulan. Like Birds of Prey, Mulan is expected to have a much smaller debut than other entries in its same franchise. And I'd like to point out that both those films had very strong male and female characters. And on that note, Mulan has made many of the same mistakes that Birds of Prey has made. And while the original animated film featured strong supporting male characters, and not just strong supporting male characters, but big male energy. And I'd like to point out, they did not overshadow Mulan. But both Li Shang and Mushu have been cut from the live-action movie. Now, to be fair, Donnie freaking Yen is in this new movie. He's fantastic, and he's a huge superstar. She still has a love interest, this time a fellow soldier at the same level as her, not above her like Shang was. And then Yao Ling and Qian Po also return, but none of them have been played up in the trailers. Really, only Donnie Yen has made kind of an appearance. The rest of them, really not at all. The new love interest did get a poster, to his credit. He looks super cool. But, you know, Disney has already released the final trailer for this movie, so maybe they could do some TV spots to play these characters up so they don't have the same problems at the box office that Birds of Prey had. I don't know why they would hide these characters. They're so great. Now, next up, Black Widow. This film has strong male supporting characters in place. Creatively, it did the work, but marketing-wise, it's not doing the work, right? They have not really advertised them at all. Sure, Scarlett Johansson, Florence Pugh, and Rachel Weisz all look very cool in this new movie, but David Harbour is a fan favorite, and he's been in the trailers, but not as much as I think he should be, especially post-Birds of Prey. He is a fan favorite actor, and he's playing a very cool and interesting character, Russia's version of Captain America. I can't believe they're doing Red Sun first to some degree. Taskmaster isn't getting nearly the spotlight that he should, despite intense interest from the fan base. Now, some of you think Taskmaster is actually Rachel Weisz, but it's Otifag Benley. And he hasn't been shown in the trailers at all, even as the other character he's playing to kind of, I think, throw you off, right? He was at Comic-Con. It's not a secret that he's in the movie. Why hasn't he been put in the trailers? Ray Winstone and William Hurt are also in the film, and they should be played up as well. Black Widow has probably at least one more trailer left to go, and hopefully they fix this marketing mistake. It has a bit of a cushion that it's part of the MCU, but you don't want to be one of the Ant-Mans of the MCU, right? You want to be an Ant-Man and the Wasp. Black Widow needs to be another Captain Marvel, which means it needs to get into the $1 billion club, or at least pretty darn close. Wonder Woman 1984. This movie is in excellent shape, just as the first one was, thanks to Chris Pine's Steve Trevor. And Patty Jenkins and Warner Brothers know how important he is, as they brought him back from the dead for the sequel. My dad loved Wonder Woman, not just because of Gal Gadot, he thought she was wonderful, but he really liked Pine's Steve Trevor. He could really relate to him. And after that movie, he in fact became a huge Chris Pine fan. Watch I Am the Night from Jenkins and Pine, with Pine starring. It's very, very good. And my family watched it because my dad loves Chris Pine so much from that movie. And, you know, and we were rewarded, as I said, it's very good. But I do not underestimate what Chris Pine brought to that first film. What I believe he'll bring to the second as well. Pine's Trevor is truly Wonder Woman's Lois Lane, but even better as he gets to be in on the action. And this dynamic, make no mistake about it, is what helps Wonder Woman stay at the front of the pack success-wise. Pedro Pascal is also in Wonder Woman 1984, but I think you can't just, it would be very bad if the only strong male character in the movie was the villain, because that's the mistake Birds of Prey made. I think Birds of Prey felt it had male representation, but it made them all the bad guys. Now, Eternals. I'm including this film because it has an indie female director and many strong female characters. But as you can see from this cast lineup, it has the kind of balanced cast that would make Thanos proud, right? It's perfectly balanced, as all things should be. And we're talking not just in terms of gender, but also ethnicity, and as Feige has promised, sexuality. We'll see how the movie does, but from a business perspective, it's beautifully constructed. And then finally, WandaVision. Oh, fans are chomping at the bit for this Disney Plus series, where Elizabeth Olsen's Wanda will finally get to be front and center, and her most iconic comic book story will finally be adapted for the small screen. We'll also see Monica Rambeau, all grown up, very well-known Marvel character. Well, Kat Dennings returns to the MCU, and Catherine Hahn is going to be in the cast and is rumored to be playing Agatha Harkness, an immortal witch. Cool character. But again, Paul Bettany's vision is also front and center. He's in the freaking title. Well, Randall Park also returns. We haven't gotten a full trailer for that, and I'm sure they will play up all of those characters. Wanda and Vision's twin boys are also set to debut. Wiccan, one of the most famous LGBT characters in comics, he has powers similar to his mother, and then his twin brother Speed, who of course takes after Wanda's dear departed brother Pietro. So it would seem, I think, that Mulan is probably going to similarly underperform to Birds of Prey, unless they can fix the optics on that. Cause it's a shame, because it does seem to be in the film itself. And of course, the relationship with her father, I think that's all really beautiful, but they're not playing up enough. I think Black Widow is in some danger, we'll see, but I think Wonder Woman 1984, Eternals, and WandaVision are all in very good shape business-wise, and I think are poised to do much better, or just do well at all at the box office after Birds of Prey bombed. So what do you think? Share your thoughts down below, subscribe today, and of course, as always, you can check out some more videos right now.